It's 3:13 a.m. I traveled to Kozlova many years ago, having read in a travel magazine about its fountains. It was true, they were striking and plentiful. I took picture after picture. And I walked through Kozlova's galleries and ate in a small restaurant and took a history tour. I sat down by the famous canal and watched the people, almost all of them young. I was glad to be caught up in so much living, so much bustle. But when night came, the restaurants closed their doors. The shops shut down, the streets emptied. I was confused. Everyone seemed to be going home, but there was dinner to be eaten, and bars to be populated, nightlife to begin. None of that happened. By the time the sky was fully dark, no one was out, and the city, on a Saturday evening, had shut down. There was silence. No one had told me this would happen. I walked back to my hotel where I asked the man at the front desk why no one was outside. "We don't like the dark," he said. It was not that they were afraid of it, that was absurd. They simply liked it more when it was light. All of Kozlova was at home now, and that's the way it was every night of the year, regardless of the season. I wanted to explore this phenomenon. I stayed longer in Kozlova and arranged to speak to its mayor. After much cajoling, I convinced her to take a moonlight walk with me down what was, during the day, the busiest street in the city, but which after dark was utterly abandoned. She and I left her house and walked. She asked me to explain to her what I was seeing, that the people of the city had missed for 400 years. I pointed out the way the stars in the sky seemed to disappear and appear again, winking in and out of existence. The way the headlights of an ambulance ambling along toward no place in particular washed down an alleyway, creating a small pool of yellow light on the cobblestones that grew and grew. The way the lights of a houseboat across the canal were mirrored in the surface of the rippling water. I pointed out the dark, seemingly ugly places where two people in love might at night feel emboldened to take one another's hand. And I told her of what it was like to stay out till almost dawn, having drunk too much, said too much, and walk alone, just a little heartbroken, toward home. We were 2 hours together, and at the end of that time, the mayor shook my hand, said she thought she understood, and would go to the people of the city with what she had learned. It was the very next day that she faithfully reported our walk to the rest of Kozlova in the editorial section of the newspaper. And that night, instead of rushing home when dusk fell, the city stayed out. The cafes and bars kept their doors open, the shops took in customers, and the central business district came alive. There was laughter and traffic, and people looking at the sky, finding it agreeable. Music seemed to be everywhere, and the canal was filled with people gazing out over the water. I had to leave for the train station at 7:30, sorry to leave them. I got on the train, and it pulled out, taking me away, doing a slow half-circle around Kozlova before it headed north. It seemed that as soon as I boarded, something began to happen. I looked out the window on city street after city street, which seemed to be emptying. People were going indoors again, not rushing, but going indoors nonetheless. A line of cars had formed, leaving the city center, where lights were going out and shades were being drawn over bars which had been busy just 20 minutes before. Kozlova was returning to its former state. The experiment was ending already, even before 8 o'clock. I saw the mayor walking back toward her stately house, alone. At one point, the train rolled within a few hundred feet of a column of people all headed away from each other. I made eye contact with a policeman, and recognized him from the night before, when we had chatted briefly as he walked his solitary beat. Now off duty, he was going home just like everyone else, holding the hand of his young son. A little ashamed, he nodded at me and tried to smile. He tapped a stranger on the shoulder and gestured toward me, obviously letting the stranger know who I was. That person raised a hand and waved. Soon a few others were waving. Their expressions were ones of deep humility. They had hoped I would not see their abandonment of the night, were regretful they hadn't waited a little longer to go back home, out of respect for my efforts. They hadn't realized I'd be watching from the train. I raised a hand back to them. They had tried, and simply had not been able to become anything they weren't meant to be. The train rolled out of Kozlova, and in all likelihood, the streets of the city were empty by 8:30. From what I have heard, Kozlova remains a city of day. I will go back to see the fountains and the galleries and the canal, sometime when summer again takes me toward that region of the world. The Civil War reenactor spent a summer weekend performing the Battle of Antietam with others. On Saturday, he and his fellow actors marched 7 miles toward the field where they would go to war. Passing cars slowed to watch them, and a small crowd formed to observe them set up camp for the night. They pitched tents, built fires, and cleaned their guns. And when all the tourists had gone home, they relaxed their illusion and drank and sang and had a very good time. The Civil War reenactor woke at dawn. He walked through a famous trench where hundreds of men had died. And in the morning chill, he found himself looking at a black and white photograph posted on a fence, which depicted the grisly aftermath of the original day. Corpses filled the frame. His eyes were drawn to the soldier closest in the foreground, at the way the man's body was so awkwardly positioned, as if the act of dying had required him to cruelly contort himself so as to lose the precious shred of his dignity that remained. When the staged battle began a couple of hours later, the Civil War reenactor played his part with zeal, as always. Orders were shouted at him by more experienced performers, and he followed them. The sound of gunfire filled the hills once again as hundreds of tourists and picnickers watched the blue and gray armies converge. The moment came when the Civil War reenactor was forced to fall to an enemy gunshot. He did so enthusiastically. This time, though, he tried to fall to the ground in just such a way as to mimic perfectly the corpse he had seen in the black and white photograph. He hit the earth, rolled over, and cocked his left elbow into the air. His face was pressed hard against the grass, and his right foot was bent at a painful angle. He slowed his breathing, keeping his chest almost still. His prone body now bore a great similarity to the one that had lain at Antietam 140 years before. The Civil War reenactor stayed that way, despite being so uncomfortable, for a full half hour, so that the illusion of death was almost perfect. Only when the battle was fully over and the people applauded the actor's efforts did he rise. After lunch with his fellow actors, he changed back into his street clothes. He intended to do a few hours of work in his law office before dark. It began to rain, and the crowds cleared out quickly. He got into his car and drove down the road toward his place of business, three towns over. At some point, though, he turned the car around, and he drove back to the field. He parked and walked through the rain toward the trench where that soldier had fallen long ago. This time, he walked to the exact spot where it had happened. He lay down very carefully on the wet ground, then carefully contorted his body into position once again, his left elbow cocked into the air, his face against the grass, his right foot at an angle. He slowed his breathing, his chest rising and falling very slightly. The rain fell, and he closed his eyes. He tried to remain very still. He emptied his mind and lay prone in the trench at Antietam for a long time. Thunder rolled faintly overhead, far off in the distance. After a while, the pain in his joints seemed to fade. For some reason, the Civil War reenactor became sure that the dead man from long ago had had a daughter, and he thought of what her name might have been, Annette. He lay in simulation of her father's passing until nearly dusk. Soaked and cold, he finally trudged through the mud back to his car. He turned up the heat and turned on the radio. A critic was reviewing a new comedy film, and he listened to that as he drove. And then he listened to what came after, which was a talk show about the financial markets. After a hot shower and a drink at home, the reenactor decided not to go into the office. He went to bed early, and he did not dream. Some months later, the photograph depicting the corpses in the trench was replaced. It was quite faded from the changing of the seasons. The new photograph showed essentially the same scene, but was not so vivid in its graphic depiction of the dead, of the soldiers who may or may not have had daughters who loved them. While watching a movie, I heard a song I liked, and so waiting in the lobby for a friend afterwards, I opened my laptop and I downloaded it. It would remain permanently on my hard drive and my tiny music player. Now, 10 years ago, I would have had to buy the CD to possess it. 20 years ago, I sometimes waited for a particular new song to play on the radio, and then I would press record to get the sound onto a cassette tape I'd loaded into the deck. Prior to that, I sometimes held up a recorder to the radio speaker, usually missing the first 3 or 4 seconds of the song. As a teenager, when I knew of no way to record a song I'd heard and taken to, I would keep my radio on all the time, and I felt a surge of energy and happiness when that special song began to play after hours of waiting. One time I stayed up half the night because the DJ had mentioned a certain song was coming up soon. I lay in bed with the tiny radio turned down very low so as not to wake up my brother. When the song came on, I held the radio as close to my ear as I could. There was a time as a child when I had no radio at all. One day I was in a restaurant with my parents when I heard a song that I just had to hear again. Later that day, I told my best friend about it. He had heard it too. Spending time that summer in places where there was a radio was a mixture of hope and frustration. The song never seemed to come on. I started to forget how it went. Then my father took me to a baseball game, and between the second and third innings, the song blared over the loudspeaker to 20,000 people, and I jumped up on my seat in excitement. And on a summer night in the middle of the 17th century, a very distant descendant of mine took his wife to see a pianist give a concert of an original work. When the couple walked home afterwards down a country lane, the woman told her husband she wished she could hear that music again someday, knowing she probably never could. Her husband had an idea. 6 months later, he tracked down the sheet music on a business trip to a faraway capital city. When his wife was away visiting her mother, he lit some candles and played the piano well into the night, knowing he could never get the notes just right, but hoping to at least approximate the melody for her. For 2 days, he practiced and did little else. When his wife returned, he told her there would be a surprise after dinner that night, and he played for her. She had never been so happy or so beautiful as when she heard the first few clumsy, hesitant notes and knew that finally, finally, the moment had arrived. On a late October day, the poet traveled into the Ring Mist Mountains with friends to camp out for the night. He was 28 years old, but had never been. They all shopped cheerfully for gear, buying too many things and knowing it. And by 2 o'clock, they'd arrived at their campsite, a half mile or so away from the nearest others. After a trail walk, the men split off to gather firewood, while the women started preparing dinner. It had gotten cold, colder than the weather forecast had indicated. Having very little money, the poet hadn't bought a tent at the sporting goods store, intending to rely only on his sleeping bag for warmth. At midnight, they all retired to their tents, and the poet was left alone, withdrawing deep into his sleeping bag against the wind. He had not expected the ground to be so hard and to conduct such cold. He lay awake, shivering, dozing in and out of sleep, for 2 hours. At a little past 4 a.m., he came awake and knew he could endure it no longer. He dared to leave his sleeping bag, shaking, his hands numb. He walked quickly through the woods toward the light of a distant campsite. Soon he began to run. He made it to a small building with a men's and women's bathroom and went inside. The feeling of warmth that greeted him was overpowering. In a moment, he went from misery to an all-consuming contentment. The warmth infused every part of his body, his very being. He remained there, slumped down in a decrepit shower stall, eyes heavy-lidded. At some point, he fell asleep. When he awoke the next day, he told his friends of his adventure, and they kidded him about it on the drive back home, admiring his courage. Only a week later, The poet found himself back at the construction site where he worked, during an unseasonably warm day. After digging in a trench for 2 hours without a drink of water, he was in agony, sweating and parched. Someone went for a can of ginger ale and brought it to him. The first swallow made him almost dizzy with relief. He'd never tasted anything so fine. From that day on, the poet made himself suffer. He would not eat until his hunger hurt his head. He walked the streets at night until almost collapsing from exhaustion before returning to lie on his bed. He spent 2 entire days in an utterly lightless basement to feel what stepping out into the sun would be like afterward. In this way, he experienced a level of pleasure no one around him seemed to know. He endured untold hours of misery for the 30 seconds of ecstasy afterward. In time, he began to be normal again, of course, and wrote of what he had felt in his notebook. Some years passed, and the poet became a success. He became wealthy. He bought a very nice car and a large loft apartment in the city. He had savings and traveled extensively, giving readings and teaching. His books sold very well. By the age of 40, he lacked for nothing and had moved to Southern California. There were no more camping trips. One December weekend, he attended a writer's conference in Massachusetts and stayed at a beach house owned by a friend. He spent a quiet evening reading, and very late went briefly out onto the deck to look at the moonlight glittering on the ocean. Turning around afterward, he realized he had not taken his key and had locked himself out of the house. He stood in his robe, the situation sinking in. It was less than 20 degrees outside. Frantically, he circled the house, looking for an unlocked window, but there was none. He considered breaking a window, but then saw the silhouette of another house well down the beach. There seemed to be a light on. He began to walk down the shoreline. As a younger man, the poet had the fitness to run, but not now. The wind cut into him along the shore, and he wrapped his arms around himself, already shaking uncontrollably. When he reached the stranger's house, he found that it, too, was empty. The light meant nothing. And so he went on down the beach, knowing he would have to break into the next house he came to. There was not even one in sight. His hands and his legs froze. He was so miserable he could not even think about frostbite. The next house, when it finally appeared, was a smaller one and completely dark. He pounded on the door anyway. Just as he was about to break a window, the door opened. Inside stood a scrawny, emaciated-looking man. The poet begged to come inside, unable to even speak clearly. The homeless man who had broken in just hours before stepped aside. The poet collapsed in a chair, the warmth rushing through him and filling all that had been hollowed out by the cold. For a moment, the sensation was so great that he became delirious and the room spun. Then, total peace, relief, gratitude. The homeless man said to him, "It's nice to come in from the cold." The poet did not make a call for a taxi or a locksmith. Instead, he slept right there in that chair, while the homeless man slept in another, respectful of the house and the possessions that belonged to strangers. 1 month later, the poet was seen in New York City. A friend spotted him there late one night, sitting beside a clock tower in a park. The poet wore only a t-shirt and jeans, not even shoes in the chilly temperatures. He was unshaven, haggard. The friend asked him if he was all right. The poet said he was very hungry, but that it wasn't yet time to eat. He had no money, having given away everything he owned. When the friend left him, the poet smiled, continuing to wait for just the right moment to go indoors and discover what there might be to fill him and make him whole. Walking through the city once, I dropped a quarter as I bought a newspaper. It rolled a few feet down the sidewalk and hit a man's shoe. He bent down to retrieve it for me, but another man did as well. They both touched the coin at the same time, and both wanted to return it to me. They exchanged a tense glance and left the coin where it was while they tried to sort out who would give me my quarter. But they could not come to an agreement about whose right it was to do this good deed. Leaving me out of the conversation, they agreed to allow a third party to hold the quarter until it was all sorted out. A woman stepped forward then to say that she should be the one to return my quarter, as she had pointed it out as it rolled, alerting the first man to its location. But the teenage boy who had initially tried to catch it as it fell out of my hand, laid a claim as well. They all wanted to return my quarter with a modest, "Don't mention it." It became a matter for the courts. My quarter was held by the city as the case went forward. But then the city itself decided to sue for the right to return my quarter. After all, it owned the sidewalk where it had fallen. The state asserted that it had jurisdiction, and things escalated. It became a topic on news shows, and pundits agreed that Congress had no other choice but to get involved. After all, it must be decided once and for all who owned a good deed. And the country became divided. Some believed in the right of the individual to return my quarter, while others felt that a benevolent deed must be shared by as many people as possible in order to promote a sense of goodwill. A senatorial candidate from Wyoming based his platform on the case, and opinion polls were conducted weekly as it dragged on. There was finally a verdict, and all seemed settled. But then there came the inevitable appeal, which was a complicated one. There was a looming sense that without a Supreme Court decision, the fate of the quarter would never be justly decided. The heads of other nations lent their opinions on the issue, anxious as anyone to bring it nearer to a resolution. 4.5 years after I dropped the quarter, a verdict was handed down by the Supreme Court. This time, the ensuing appeal seemed half-hearted and poorly presented. I read in the newspaper 8 months after it was filed that the decision to award credit for the good deed was essentially final. I had retired from Wall Street by then and moved to the country to lead a quieter life. In the mornings, I painted the woods behind my house, and at night I read a great deal. One morning, a letter was delivered to me by registered mail. I opened it up and saw that it was a brief letter from the Secretary of the United States Treasury. All legal issues settled, and all credit publicly given to the proper parties for its return, my quarter was finally being given back to me. It was taped neatly at the bottom of the page. It looked like someone had cleaned it, though there was a small scratch in it now. I peeled off the tape, put the letter in a drawer, and placed the coin in my pocket. It was spent 2 weeks later at the local convenience store, sometime past midnight, when I walked there, unable to sleep, to buy a bottle of iced tea. Near dusk of a very cold winter's day, I came across a flea market on a side street in the city. Everyone there was closing up for the day, but I managed a unique find. A man was selling thousands upon thousands of family photographs he'd purchased himself at various estate sales over the years. The photos of families he had never known were lined up in cardboard boxes spread across three tables. Thinking there was some good art project I could use a box of these for, I bought one. As it happened, my box contained a few hundred photos from the collection of a single family, which had put their cameras to good use between 1920 or so and the late 70s. Going through the photos that night as the wind and snow howled around my house, I ascertained that the family's name had been Lorraine. The photos were in very rough chronological order, judging from the occasional dates and notations written on their backs, and from the growth of several members of the Lorraine family. The story that developed itself through these photos hinted at a normal, happy enough clan, though I found myself worried for a small, camera-shy boy who apparently had two sisters. The boy simply looked so gawky and skinny and odd that as he grew in the photos from age six or so into his more awkward teen years, I didn't see much hope for his marriage possibilities. I could figure out only that his first name began with a C. I was happy then when there were a dozen or so photos depicting C's wedding day to a subdued but not unattractive woman. The reception seemed to have been held in a VFW hall somewhere in the Midwest. As a man in his 20s, C was very tall, somewhat hunched over, still rail thin, with crooked teeth and bad hair. But he had found his love. Later photos proved that they went on to have two children. C lost his hair fairly quickly. His wife seemed very distant in all the photos, and I realized that not a single picture in the collection showed either of them smiling. Then C disappeared from the family photos for a long period. His plain wife, still averse to smiling for the camera, seemed to be raising the children by herself all the way through their teens. And there was no C at two different high school graduations. I was sad at the thought of his death and frustrated to think that I would never know the reason there may have been a divorce. Somewhere in the stack, there was a very faded black and white photograph of a prison, and then a picture of a gaunt-looking C in an inmate's uniform, standing beside his wife against a brick wall, outdoors on a sunny day. They seemed to be in their late 30s. Neither was smiling. The children weren't there. So that's why he was gone, I thought. How strange. What could he have done? The husband and wife and children did not seem poor or without strong ties to their extended families. I feared I wouldn't ever know the end of the story as I neared the end of the stack. C did not reappear as his wife's hair became grayer and grayer. Their children off on their own began to marry and begin their own families. The last photo I came across is the one I've kept with me and always will. It's a color Polaroid of C and his wife, alone in the frame, their age about 60. They seem to be at a party. They've been reunited, and both of them are looking off to the right at something, and both of them are laughing heartily. C's arm around his wife's shoulder as if they're on a first date. In that moment, whatever sadness there had been between them was banished completely, leaving them with laughter and visible smiles which had been so absent from every other photograph spanning their entire history. C's face is utterly alight and mischievously youthful, and she seems downright girlish in her amusement at whatever has happened, whatever someone has said. It was as if it had taken them a lifetime to learn how to laugh. And despite everything that had come before, they made it seem like the most natural thing in the world. How the photos came to be at the flea market, I don't know, and I don't care to know, for it seems like there might be some sadness there. Or maybe in that case, too, a single picture of a single moment would wipe it all away. Years and years of history, wonderfully losing all their painful meaning in a perfect instant preserved on film. Stranded on the Pacific Island, the explorer had to find ways to keep sane. Slowly, though, she felt her mind losing control over itself. She seemingly had nothing to live for. While the island was beautiful, covered in acre upon acre of tall, waving grasses spread over rolling hills, her solitude was crushing, overwhelming. She turned to her last hope in the fifth month on the island. She had long since filled her only notebook with her thoughts, so she began writing upon leaves. Slowly, she was composing a language. It was the language of the grass, whose sounds she heard every moment she was awake. The grass rustled, swayed, settled, sighed, day in and day out. And she would ascribe to it genuine speech based on its patterns and pauses, the durations of its motions compared to the moments in between when it settled. If the grass took its full height because of a strong wind, it would mean one thing. If a slight breeze lifted it only slightly, it would mean quite another. The direction in which the wind pushed it would alter what it was trying to say as well. The explorer was a profoundly sad woman during her time on the island, but she was honest in the language she composed, knowing that the grass must too be allowed to express sorrow as well as joy. So she tried to give it every emotion she herself had ever felt. She was eventually able to commit the language to memory, and so when she awoke in the morning, the grass was already speaking to her, and she knew what it was saying. Anytime she chose to listen to it, its language surrounded her. Or she could go to a part of the island where she heard nothing and be alone. The grass was content much more often than not, and only rarely sad. Sometimes it was in a humorous mood, and sometimes it told her it had a secret it did not wish to reveal. Sometimes it even asked her questions, which she answered out loud. Once she noted an especially interesting pattern which occurred during the beginnings of a tropical storm. Looking carefully over her notes, she saw that she was being told to make sure to keep an eye on the horizon, even in the face of gale-force winds, as a rescue ship might cruise through the area on a distress call. When the wind was from the east on the island's tallest hill, and the grass was wet from the rain, and the moon overhead was full, she looked forward to a gentle waving motion, followed by a brief pause, and then a delicate rustle that was barely audible. When these things happened in exact sequence, the explorer felt something approaching hope. The tall grass, her ally and talkative friend, was telling her everything was going to be all right. The first time I ever heard of Brick Ellen, I was in a quiet bar at the edge of town. The good bars, an acquaintance told me, were supposedly in Dakota Heights, West End, and Brick Ellen. The next time I heard of it, I was having a discussion with someone about housing prices. Pineberry, Sawyer, and Radcliffe Station were not where the best values were, my coworker told me. He was hoping to find a little place in Trenton Town, White Springs, or Brick Ellen. You heard the name when people spoke of schools and parks, of neighborhoods where crime was either fading or becoming more commonplace. Some celebrity was supposedly born in Brick Ellen, or maybe it was Lake Ridge. Brick Ellen was a long, long walk to the nearest ride line station, and it was said that Halloween was definitely best spent at one of the area's parties. They really did that night right. There had been gang sightings there a few years back, but the gangs had moved on. And now Brick Ellen was always mentioned when it came to where a good place would be to open a small art studio or coffee shop. The people there were either young or old, and for some reason it was a cat neighborhood, not a dog one, and always had been. I went for a long walk one evening and decided to see the area for myself. But I wasn't able to find it listed on the old street map I had bought. A local bookstore clerk knew of it. He thought his freshman year roommate had grown up there, but he didn't know where to point me. The cashier at the gas station, a policeman, a woman carrying her groceries to her car. All of them were unsure of where Brick Ellen was. I walked till almost 11 and asked people in bars and on the street where to find the neighborhood they had all known about. I got more facts about it, but no directions. I walked until my legs hurt, but of course I suspected that Brick Ellen did not exist. How many people had I known who had dropped its name so casually, yet had never been able to name one of its restaurants, or tell me exactly which part of Bell Avenue I should turn off to get there? How many times had I read the local paper and seen it mentioned only vaguely in rambling editorials, yet never once identified as the site of either a newsworthy incident or a community event? I sat down on a bench near the city pier and thought about telling everyone I knew of the great unspoken lie we all lived with, of demanding answers. Surely I could not be the only one who had gone walking late at night in search of what the summer breeze might feel like in Brick Ellen, only to discover this empty conspiracy. But as it grew even later, and I found myself sitting alone on the pier, I chose instead to imagine my own vision of Brick Ellen. I imagined myself living above the laundromat there, in a cramped studio apartment a friend had tipped me off to, and riding my bicycle along a pair of weathered train tracks to work every day. At night I would stop by the dive bar around the corner, and on Tuesdays go to my watercolor class at the Brick Ellen Art Center. On Saturdays, there would be the farmer's market in the square, always on the lookout for the woman of my dreams. And Sundays were about the park and watching people work in the communal garden on Shakespeare Street. Best of all, Brick Ellen would be the place I would move in order to get away from the kind of stifling people who had spoken of it all these years. Educated, somewhat affluent souls quietly suffocated by their good jobs, their pleasant families, their mortgages, their cell phone plans. They were people just like me. I knew by the time I returned to my apartment that night and laid my head on my pillow that I would not speak of Brick Ellen again, unless it was to suggest to someone that it might be one of the places to find a used bookstore, or to warn them away from the Safeway there because it was so poorly laid out. I feel certain that as the years pass, I too will come to mention its name without even knowing I'm doing it. Psychically attuned to my other, materially comfortable friends and our harmless desire to believe that there might be a nearby place just a little better for us, or at least new and unspoiled, which we might explore and come to like, if life will ever give us the saving push we cannot ourselves create. We would never ask for Paris or Japan or life on a hill in Tibet. We ask only for Brick Ellen, for its thrift stores, its pretty cemetery, its humid summer evenings. It's 3:13 a.m. The museum was off the beaten path, several blocks away from the tourist section of town. I stumbled across it by accident when I was looking for a place to have dinner. I went inside, not knowing quite what to expect, just grateful as the sun went down for the air conditioning and the rest from my miles of rapid walking. I had heard the museum was almost always unattended and that the exhibits never changed. The museum was a one-way affair, a long, narrow building in which the only way to go was forward. In the front hall, there were paintings by some of the lesser-known Dutch masters, impressive things lit tastefully and carefully. As always, many of these seemed to me almost untouchably brilliant. Beyond that, it became a bit of a mix. The Impressionists leading to the Realists, their genius undeniably daunting, and then suddenly the museum was all about sculpture. Asian sculpture, most of all. Then came an interesting mix of stained glass works and hanging rugs. The melange was a little bit clumsy, a little disorienting, but of course it was all interesting. American folk art came next, things crafted purely for the love of it. Some of the objects in this section had utility as well as beauty. The last object I examined in this hall appeared to be little more than an 18th century coffee pot, with simple Christian imagery cut carefully into its side by a devoted craftsman. I was confused by what I found next in the museum's progression. There was a room of what appeared to be folk art, but which in reality was nothing more than an accumulation of everyday objects, whose context may have sparked interest in some. A shovel used to throw dirt on Tennyson's grave, a toothbrush found at Pompeii. I wasn't sure what the museum was trying to go for here, but it was pleasant just to be inside and not knowing what I might discover as I walked along. What came next completely flummoxed me. The objects in the room were poised on white stands, but now there were no small white placards explaining their history or significance. I looked at a typewriter, no more than 20 years old, a sealed pack of new pencils, a roll of pennies, a Houston Astros baseball cap, a cheap silver pin in the shape of an alligator. After that, the museum's objects were merely spread out on a long white table in an empty room, one lit and painted in just the same way as all the others. There was a small jar of ink, some warped blocks of wood, a stack of paper, a jug of water, an unlit candle. The last room in the museum showed me things that were merely sitting on the wooden floor. I saw a piece of discolored paper with what appeared to be a small accumulation of dirt holding it down, a piece of yellowed chalk broken in half, and a frayed bit of string. I walked through the door at the other end of the room and found myself outside again, on a quiet sidewalk. Turning around, I saw a sign that said, "Entrance," exactly like the one on the other side of the museum. And so, I went back through it, as if I had approached it from that direction. From a frayed bit of old string on a barren floor, the efforts of humanity rose until Portrait of a Woman Dressed as a Huntress and Rest During the Flight to Egypt had been created and displayed for all who came to see the spirit within them. Beyond that, I was on the street once again, standing in the moonlight, and thinking of what sort of directions I would give someone who asked me where the museum was, whether I would send them to the door on 4th Avenue or the one on Shamrock Street, and how it would affect the way they saw the world. Our friend Yale refused to do anything but make films since the time he was 14. At some point or another, he ensnared us all as actors or even editors as he churned out his funny, very strange, no-budget movies, in between working just enough to live, and live out of his van most of the time. The movies were overly brilliant, really, usually too difficult to follow, too dense, but hilarious to us all the same. He never screened them for anyone but the people he knew. The one time he submitted something to a film festival, one of the 5 or so feature-length comedies he made by the age of 23, it was a disaster, and he vowed never to do it again. And so he waited tables and made his movies, one after the other, stories no one else would ever find it sane to tell. Usually his friend Liam edited them in his home studio. Funny but troubled Liam, who couldn't hold a regular job because of his bipolar illness. They were quite a pair whenever they were around each other, bouncing loopy ideas off anyone nearby. Ones touched occasionally by authentic genius. We worried about Yale when he got very sick one year and had no health insurance. And then, scarier still, he was robbed in the van. There were no movies for a while, and he was deeply depressed. But then something very wonderful happened to him. He met a girl while at work, and fell in love with her, and she returned his affections. And for the first time, from Yale's mind came love stories. His movies became more linear, more accessible, more poignant, better and better. We thought that it was only a matter of time before he truly broke through with something amazing, thanks to her. But during this time, we saw less and less of Yale. He began to spend entire days in a vast, barren stretch of landscape on the edge of the city, a place they called the East Empty, miles of decrepit scrubland that were supposed to have been developed decades before and had gone to seed instead. Yale went there, he said, because only there could he get away from everything and live entirely in his imagination, which he found a more rewarding place than any other. He would park the van and walk those flat, depressing acres and think, muse, come up with his next idea. There were times I knew he was going without food and working dangerously few hours at the restaurant. The girl ended her relationship with Yale in the middle of winter. Much of the reason was her inability to understand what he truly wanted from life. and from the east empty, which he called the only world that accepted him. His poverty and his dedication to make his movies only for himself, with seemingly no tangible reward, was too much for her in the end. Yale became more moody after that, less concerned with his appearance and health. He seemed even stranger to those who didn't know him well. And he began to speak more wildly of vaster projects, films hours and hours long, stories we honestly felt no one would ever want to see. They didn't seem funny or heartfelt, just bleak, too honest, and too obscure. It was I who had to drive out to the East Empty one day and tell Yale that his friend Liam had taken his own life at the age of 27. From that point on, Yale spent all his time in the East Empty, compiling messy volumes of notes for projects, yet never shooting a single new frame of footage with his used video camera. When after a year he had finally produced a new movie, shot entirely on his own with a cast consisting only of himself, it was impenetrable, a mere curiosity. Soon after that, he was arrested for defacing the marquee of a movie theater in town. He couldn't even say why he had done it. He became ill again and got sicker and sicker until his parents begged him to come back and live with them. Between medical treatments, he sat alone in that wasteland and dreamed his creative dreams. We started to mourn him, sensing a final mental or physical break was coming. We reached out to him, but we were always rebuffed. I recall a rainy Sunday when I decided to drive out to see him. I spotted the van off a dirt road that had been abandoned years before, but he didn't seem to be inside. I waited for him, but he didn't come back to it. And I thought I had been a poor friend, unable to figure him out, just like the girl, just like everyone else. I wondered what I would say at his funeral, and felt ashamed for having that notion. I only hoped someone would show one of his early quirky movies there, no matter how odd it seemed. He called me late one night and said he needed to see me. He drove his van to my house, and I was stunned to see he was more animated than he'd been in 2 years or more. He looked pale and weak, but he spoke until dawn of an idea for a film that had suddenly consumed him. It was everything. Comedy, drama, love story, thriller, science fiction story. I was awed. It sounded incredible and, frankly, groundbreaking, far beyond anything he'd ever tried. His fervor for the movie seemed to bring him back from the brink. Over the course of months, he worked on his script and eventually got a new part-time job. When I next saw him, he was back up to his normal weight, had cut his hair short, and had a new camera. One he had not exactly paid for, he told me with an easy smile. The first smile I had seen on his face in a long, long time. He would begin shooting his movie the very next day at dawn, and asked me if I would be around to play a small part. It's been the biggest, most time-consuming project of Yale's life, and it's still going 8 months later. Soon, he says, he'll be ready to edit. He has not returned to the East Empty, and will not speak of it when it's mentioned. Instead, he's moved to Sugar Lake Mountain, 20 miles north of town, where he parks his van around the lake according to which view he wants to see most. Blessedly, the darkness he holds within him could not take him all the way down. We, his friends, remind ourselves once in a while that he may never be on a perfectly even keel and immune to danger. But tonight he is well. And I can imagine him sitting in the folding chair he's had for ages and looking at the moonlight streak the water and dreaming about his movies and probably nothing else. He is still the only one I know who is doing exactly what he wants each and every day. He speaks about getting an apartment next year after the movie is done. He gets quiet when anyone talks about the possibility of sharing his life with someone, but that's all right. Recovery is a long process. In a way, I hope he lives alone forever in that awful green van, to remind me that it may just be possible to go through life's entire journey on your own terms, doing what you love most, being awake, being different, making it all into a movie set where you have divine control. The designer of book jackets won acclaim, wealth, and admiration, not just from people in his own industry, but all over the art world. After he had established himself as the master of expressing a book's themes and purpose with a single image, he did only 4 covers a year, each one eagerly anticipated. He became so famous at what he did that an author was considered to have made it when his or her book was chosen to be completed by the designer's work. A day came when one of the most esteemed writers in the country wrote to the designer, offering him a great deal of money if he would draw a jacket for a novel he was having trouble finishing, just because he felt the designer might be able to capture the essence of the book through an image that might inspire its completion. The designer accepted the offer, and a month after reading a draft of the novel, he sent an image to the author. The author thanked him kindly, paid him, then sat down with the image to muse upon it. He did not write for weeks. The book jacket depicted a hunched human silhouette exerting a great effort to point a stick toward a blood-red sun. The author could not fathom why his book should have inspired such a drawing, yet something about it was so haunting, so pure, that he accepted it completely. He thought and thought about the silhouette, the stick, and the sun, and their relation to the words he had written. Deep in his heart, he was convinced that the jacket designer was a deeper, more sensitive artist than he was, and the image he had drawn held the key to which direction the novel should go next. After 3 months, the author wrote to the designer and asked him for guidance. What had inspired the drawing? He had to know. But the artist couldn't be of much help. He wasn't sure himself what he was trying to express. He had only known that the image was right somehow, the colors necessary, the mountain range shown in the distance covered in ice because it had to be. The author agreed. They met from time to time after that, once every 6 months or so, and set the drawing between them, and talked about art and the novel and life itself, trying to understand where the image had come from. No matter how they tried to tie it into the author's uncompleted book, it didn't quite make sense. But the author would not finish his book until it could connect to the jacket on some thematic or symbolic level he knew he had missed. It has been 11 years since they last met, and that novel has never been finished. The drawing today hangs over the author's fireplace. He sits there and looks at it sometimes, and forgets more and more of the details of the book he had tried to write. Others came after that one, and he has never been less than successful, even in his declining years. But that book simply went away. The connection to the image never successfully made by either man. To this day, it is the great mystery of their creative lives, its inspiration never wholly understood, its brilliance drifting unattached in the world of ideas. The image can be touched and seen, even felt, but its small soul is, and most likely always will be, unclaimed. In Juliander, there is a boardwalk that runs along the beach beside the ocean. Summer tourists flock there, buying t-shirts, eating fries, driving bumper cars. For $2, you can walk under the words Haunted House and into a cool, dark interior. Small cars on tracks take the tourists through. You can hear the laughter from outside. The cars jerk along awkwardly past rubber skeletons, a machine that hisses a cloud of cold mist, green witches. There is a fake cemetery halfway through, and all sorts of lightning effects, the sounds of thunder. Teenagers and kids scream playfully. Grandfathers take pictures. In 5 minutes, the car bumps through a black curtain and back out beside the boardwalk. Kids pour out, pinching each other, clutching their sodas, and run to tell their friends they should go through too. And over again, the same jovial complaints about how tacky it was, how much of a ripoff, how hilariously out of date. So juvenile and kitschy. Skee-ball is more fun. Plus, there you can win a prize. In October, the haunted house closes at 6. By 6:30, there was no one on the boardwalk. The sky over the ocean is a dull red and purple, and stars can be seen in the sky. Inside the haunted house, a spider crawls across the seat of one of the cars, which now sits perfectly still in a line of them. Shadows have cloaked everything. The figures of Dracula and the Wolfman are silhouettes. Their profiles, so exaggerated during the day, look like the profiles of lonely old men. The mist machine is rusty. There's a ticking sound deep within it as moisture settles in its depths. A tiny green safety light tucked in one corner of the ceiling illuminates the fake cemetery with a pale glow. The cardboard tombstones sometimes lean almost imperceptibly when a shaft of cold air comes in through a crack in the outside wall. Beside the tombstones lies a papier-mâché man, face down. The white paint used on his cheeks looks yellow under that light. His eyes are completely black, staring at nothing. His left hand rests in a thatch of artificial grass. Dust motes settle with incredible slowness on his short legs. The spider that began on the seat of one of the cars will crawl onto his back just before 11 p.m. and remain there for hours. There is total silence, except for the sound inside the mist machine. There is no laughter, no mockery of the house's cheapness, no insults to the brevity of the paltry experience it offers. The lines of its shadows are as sharp and forbidding as the darkest castle in Europe. That soundlessness is more solemn than the deepest caves in Africa. In the middle of the night, with no one to enter it, The haunted house on the boardwalk holds as much mystery and dignity as any one place on earth. And after its demolition, 19 years from now, only a single plank from its floorboards will remain here. Move down toward 4th Street. Letters painted on it to advertise a surf shop. They'll say, Derek's Beachcomber Brigade members save 10% year-round. Get your card today. When dark falls time and time again, that plank will hold within it every secret it knew of the still nights long ago, when it breathed everything the proud house exhaled. Going through my great-grandfather's things, I came across the album, which was nothing more than an unmarked blue three-ring binder, heavy and worn. Inside it were a few hundred pages of drawings, now almost 70 years old. I had never heard that he was of an artistic bent. He'd been a banker, and apparently very level-headed, never having left the Midwest in all his life. But he had drawn all the same, though these were no ordinary drawings. They were all done in black pen, on inexpensive white paper, all dated in very small numbers in the lower right-hand corner, and, amazingly, all of them were exactly the same. As a man in his 20s, he had drawn more than 300 identical ocean scenes using the same primitive technique, merely stretching a series of freehand, loosely horizontal lines across the page to represent distant waves, which covered 2/3 of the page, then filling in the night sky all in black, with just a few pinpoints of white left to represent the stars. To each of his oceans, he had added a single sailboat, depicted with little more than a small crescent shape and a vertical line jutting from it. Sometimes his hand had been steadier than in other times, so his waves appeared either larger or smaller, and he had varied the number of stars, and the sailboat was floating gently along close to the horizon line in this picture, farther away in that one, or set more to the left or right. But those were the only variations. Every day, there was another drawing of that little sailboat, dwarfed by a nameless ocean. He had missed perhaps 9 or 10 days. Otherwise, the dates were consecutive. As I went through them in order, I began to wonder just what sort of man my great-grandfather had been to create such a mammoth, seemingly fruitless project. And then I turned to the last page in the album. Beyond the final drawing, which was just like all the others, my great-grandfather had, in the same black ink, written these words in the small, careful script that I recognized from a birthday card he had sent me when I was 4. Enough drawing. It is December 31st, 1939. I declare to myself that my little boat has finally made it across the sea. And now I'll always know what it was like to be alone on a long, long journey and making all the effort myself. It was tough to keep going sometimes, harder than I thought. I am so tired, but glad that what I set out to do is accomplished. And so last night, on January 1st, inspired by my great-grandfather's voyage that never was, I began my own, with a crude sketch of an airplane flying at night over a wide plain divided by mountains that are a little more than inverted V's on the horizon. I will draw for one full year, never missing a day if I can help it, pushing on through life's winds and rainstorms, and hoping that the end of December will bring me a gentle and well-earned landing in a place whose name matters not at all. To me, he was just a fellow player, one I didn't know all that well. But to the media, he was the hero quarterback, headed into the championship game having just lost his mother that Tuesday. It was becoming legendary how the woman had sacrificed for him again and again, and he'd vowed to play the game in her memory. My job, as the opposing team's middle linebacker, was to attack him, hit him, punish him. Before the game even started that night, there was talk on our sideline that he wouldn't be able to play at all. His grief was apparent in the way he walked, threw the ball in warm-ups, withdrew from everyone around him. We hoped it would be a fair contest, at least. He disappeared into the locker room 2 hours before kickoff and did not return until his team actually received the ball. He came out onto the field lethargically, with 80,000 people in the stadium and 100 million elsewhere, watching his every move. I rushed him early and twice came within inches of taking him down, but could not. I saw him up close, and he seemed like a completely different man from his usual good-natured self. It looked like he hadn't shaved in 3 days, since news of his mother's sudden death. His shoulders were slumped. He moved slower, yet somehow remained as elusive as ever. From the very beginning of the game, he took apart our defense with eerie precision. He marched his team down the field for 2 scores before we had even found our footing. He hit every receiver with pinpoint accuracy, anticipated every gambit we tried, stayed one step ahead of every blitz. To the network commentators, he seemed inspired. They mentioned how subdued he seemed as his teammates celebrated the touchdowns. But otherwise, only we on the field knew that he was a shell of his former self. He called a timeout at one point, and standing close to the sideline, I knew that it had nothing to do with strategy. He came back from a moment with his coach and threw a long, perfect pass for a touchdown. We started blitzing on almost every down after that. He merely released the ball quicker. Shortly before halftime, he made a clever underhanded toss to a running back in order to avoid a sack, and as the man galloped down the field, the quarterback merely stood looking up at the night sky. When thunderous cheers marked the touchdown, he didn't seem to notice. He emerged from the locker room after halftime and continued to make us suffer. Not once was he put on the ground. Long-standing passing records fell. The crowd went wild. At the end of the third quarter, he did not seem to be able to rise to his feet after an especially long huddle. A teammate helped him. He was taking longer and longer at the line of scrimmage, too. Yet he stayed in the game. He had put his team up by 6 touchdowns by the time one of our blitzes finally freed me. I charged forward between 2 linemen caught off guard and suddenly had a direct shot at the quarterback. He saw me coming and made no attempt at all, to release the ball. He allowed me to come at him head on, giving up, wanting to be hit. I drove into him as hard as I could, and he toppled backwards. I heard the expulsion of air from his chest when he struck the ground. There he stayed, immobile. He looked up at me, his bloodshot eyes wet with tears. He looked dazed, overwhelmed with sorrow. I reached a hand down to help him up, and he took it. Slowly, very slowly, he was able to stand. "Thank you, John," he said very quietly. And I said, "Good game." And he nodded and returned to his huddle. And flashbulbs popped, and millions kept watching as he played on. Flawless. Superhuman. Creating a night to remember. The pharmacist was pleased to see that his internet date was an attractive woman, in her early 30s as advertised, but the first meeting did not go so terribly well. She seemed distracted, rushed, and their topics of conversation were not terribly exciting. He found himself talking at great length about his frustration with his job, which he had warned himself against. When they parted, it was with a simple handshake and no commitment to see each other again. That was okay, he thought. Their senses of humor didn't really match up, and her taste in music was way over his head. He thought about trying again, but he didn't feel confident about it, and he didn't want to make a fool of himself. He was surprised to hear from her again a week later. She idly asked if he wanted to go out for Ethiopian food, and he said yes. Their second date was as bumpy as the first. He thought she came off as somewhat self-absorbed, answering a cell phone call from a friend in the middle of dinner, talking entirely about herself and how irritated she got with the idiots of the world, how money was always so tight, how the service at the restaurant was so poor. After dessert, she said she was tired, and he walked her to her car. Feeling he had nothing to lose, he kissed her on the cheek, to no response but a distracted wave. She drove off, and he felt terrible, inadequate. And yet a few days later, he got a message. She was going to see the new Modigliani exhibit, and wanted to know if he had any interest in going too. She was a half hour late, having stopped at a tattoo salon to look into getting one sometime. They walked through the gallery mostly in silence. He offered an observation here and there, a little joke sometimes, and she mostly just nodded or said something very brief in return. They spent some time in the gift shop, so she could buy a gift for her landlord. They talked for a while, and then she said she had some errands to do. They waved at each other, and headed in their separate directions. He didn't know what to make of things. Another dinner followed at her suggestion. It was very brief. She'd just gotten off work and insisted she looked terrible. They talked about current events, though she refused to talk about politics. They shared a laugh over a bad movie they had just seen, independently of each other. She declined dessert, said she had to get up early. For the fourth time, neither of them proposed another meeting, and for the fourth time there was a cool, somewhat awkward parting. He replayed the scene over and over again in his mind later on, wondering what he could have done differently, what he could do to make her a little happier. But in the end, he knew the best thing to do was to let it go, consider the experiment a failure, withdraw. 2 weeks went by, and the pharmacist figured she was finally gone. Then, one Wednesday night, he answered the phone, and it was her. She had gotten stuck at the subway stop closest to his house without enough money to head back in the opposite direction. Would he mind popping out and lending her just $2? He said he didn't mind at all. He went into the station, gave her the money. She laughed, apologized, thanked him, said, "See you later," and boarded the next train. He thought he missed a call from her a month later, but he realized he was mistaken. It was someone else. There was no more contact. He got up the nerve to send her a simple hello email, but she didn't respond to it. For some reason, he felt he wanted to delete the very few emails she had sent to him, so he did so. After that, he decided to give up internet dating, and he spent more and more time in his apartment. Just didn't feel much like meeting anyone new. Time went by, and somehow it became 4 years since he'd seen that woman. He thought about her sometimes, with a sadness he couldn't explain. He felt he should not forget her. She was part of his history, his collection of memories of his life on Earth. He wondered if 4 awkward dates and a late-night meeting at the subway station were enough to consider himself part of her long story as well. If she would be mad if he tried to seek her out, just to ask her who she had really been, why she had seemed so angry, and what she had sought from him that she never got. He wanted to say to her, "We were a part of each other's lives, don't you see? We were. It's true. It doesn't matter that we never kissed, that nothing worked between us, that you were a complete mystery to me, someone I'm not even sure I could even truly like as a friend. We came together, we shared time. I thought about you, you must have thought about me. Please, come back just so I can ask you what you wanted. And if there had been a chance ever that if I had done things differently, we could have connected in some way." Another winter came. He was out at night on the pier where people walked and dined beside the river, and he looked over and he saw her. She was sitting on a bench. She had tears in her eyes as she read and reread a letter she held in her hand. As he watched, she very slowly tore the letter into very small pieces. Alone again in the world, she dabbed her eyes and stared out over the dark water. "So we've both lost years," the pharmacist thought. He watched her for a time, and then, before she saw someone she didn't want to, he walked back home. For days after the bicycle accident, I would wake up in the middle of the night, delirious with medication, drifting in and out of consciousness, unaware of my condition, only vaguely knowing my own name. The room around me, unfamiliar and always so cold, could have been any place on Earth to me. All I knew was that something awful had happened, and I was close to death. Then, one rare day when I had enough awareness to make out voices, I heard two doctors talking about how I would most likely lose my legs. My mind was too unhinged in the haunted, wind-swept world of my twilight existence to feel any grief for myself, any fear. Sometimes at night, I would have a full hour of speechless consciousness, and I would see a man come into my room. It was one of the hospital janitors, and he seemed to be using my room to take his breaks in. He never seemed to notice that I could see him through heavy-lidded eyes. While he sat for 5 or 10 minutes near my window in the dark, he would look at a magazine he had brought with him, some mass circulation thing grabbed from one of the waiting rooms, maybe something about sports. He never read, only skimmed, glanced at the pictures. And then he would leave. I believe it was when my parents were informed that I had regained occasional and partial awareness that they brought some of my books to me and left them on the table beside my bed. I was still too weak to move, and so there they sat. I woke up once to see snow tapping against my window before dawn. The sound of it made me feel like I was a child wrapped in dozens of blankets. The janitor was sitting and looking at one of the books my parents had brought. After some idle flipping of pages, he found something that made him truly read. His brow furrowed with effort as he made out the words in the dark, his lips moving sometimes. The book was a history of ancient Rome. Through the medications, through the pain and the fog, I told myself that I would fight to keep living if he would just keep going a little further, read just a couple of pages of that story, rather than returning to the magazines, find out something he had never known before. Life truly was worth every agony if the janitor would only keep reading a bit longer, and I would honor it by somehow pressing onward. I faded away then, taken by sleep. I never knew if he did keep reading or not, and I was never again aware of him returning to my room. I made a slow but full recovery from the accident. Perhaps only when I marry will I ever make a vow as powerful and honest as the one I made that night, inspired by a single moment to achieve something well beyond me. Lifted out of this painful world by a delirious ambition brought to me as the snow tapped softly against my window, reminding me of blankets and warmth and being young. The detectives had been sitting in the car for 18 hours straight, hungry, unwashed, angry, desperate to go home. But their suspect had not come. They knew he would, it was only a matter of time. It had become dark again, the world asleep, and the street corner was cold and desolate. One of the detectives smoked, and the other didn't. One loved sports, and the other didn't. Things became tense quickly, and only escalated from there. The younger one, with the profane way of speaking, told the other one that there were doubts in the department about his effectiveness on big cases. The older one retorted by questioning the other's actions on a recent drug bust, which he said were borderline criminal. They swore at each other, then tried to keep as quiet as possible, but even disagreed about the music on the radio. Their breaks from each other were pitifully short. And then it was right back in the car, in the dark, on that ugly street. Another argument arose. The older one screamed at the younger one to just get out and go home. But the younger one wouldn't go. He took his partner's cigarette right out of his mouth and crushed it, refusing to get sick because of someone else's disgusting habit. Again, the insults came out about anything and everything they could imagine. These were full of venom, laced with genuine hatred, and could never be retracted. Just before dawn, their suspect came. He walked up the steps to the front door of his row house, holding a single shopping bag, and fished for his keys. The detectives fell silent, watched, waited. The moment the suspect got his key into the door, the bottom of his paper bag split wide, and a whole watermelon fell out onto the stoop with a wet splat, breaking into dozens of small pieces. It was the only thing that had been in the bag. The suspect looked down at the mess wordlessly. After several seconds of peering through the bag with a confused and pained expression on his face, he began the slow process of cleaning up. The detectives never did recall which one of them bust out laughing first, after they had done their very best to control their giggling so as not to blow their cover. The younger one shoved a fist in his mouth, desperate to contain it, to no avail. Soon they were both doubled over in laughter, unable to control it. It bubbled out of them and made them rock back and forth in their seats. The suspect heard them and looked over. When they met his gaze, they laughed only harder, and the older one slapped the steering wheel by accident. It almost caused the younger one to start hyperventilating, his laughs were so strong, and tears ran freely down his cheeks. The suspect ran, and the detectives followed, collecting themselves just enough. They were still laughing when they caught him. The suspect thought he was dealing with maniacs. The detectives did not work together again. But for years afterward, they told the story of their partnership and the poorly made paper bag that bonded them together. On a cool October night, I decided to go bounding one last time before winter came. I left the house a little after midnight and drove 10 miles west. I took a few random turns I didn't think about too much and wound up in a town I'd only been to twice before. I parked the car beside a high school and walked a few blocks in the direction that the horizon seemed most uncluttered. Using my binoculars, I scanned the night sky for something that stood out far, far in the distance. There it was, what seemed to be a church steeple, just barely visible. I set my bearings, and I began to walk. The week before, it had been a row of lit windows in a sleeping office building that became my goal. The week before that, a single mysterious winking red light on the side of what turned out to be a clock tower. In my journey toward the church steeple, I was blocked by many things. Houses whose lawns I needed to trespass on so as to keep to the straightest course possible. An unexpected stream which I almost couldn't get past. An industrial park which rerouted me a fair distance to the east. Stopping often and looking up to make sure I hadn't lost the steeple, I climbed a fence and hacked through bushes, going where I shouldn't. But bounding, as part of its rules restricting unnecessary deviation, called for such risk. There have been times in the past when I've simply lost my goal. It seemed to disappear into the night sky. And once in a while, it truly is unattainable on foot. The highway cut me off when I was just minutes from the church I had sought for a half hour. I wouldn't let speeding traffic stop me. Still keeping to a straight line until it was impossible to do otherwise, I dodged cars and made it across only to find myself in the woods, confused and feeling I had wandered too far off course. I emerged from them into a quiet neighborhood, and to my great fortune, the steeple reappeared. Feeling renewed, I stopped to buy a soda from an all-night gas station that was conveniently in my way. I was then almost separated from my goal by a security fence which bordered 20 acres of land belonging to an oil company, but I was okay. Once, while in pursuit of a farmhouse I'd spotted, I helped a man change a tire, almost fell into a stranger's swimming pool, walked within 5 feet of a group of sleeping cows, detoured around an abandoned motel that seemed haunted, and got rained on. On this night, I finally reached the church. With one finger, I softly traced my initials against the side of the building. And then I walked back to my car, using a traditional route. My adventure for one night was done. I fell asleep, wondering about the giant, gnarled tree in Westbury I never did reach, and if it would still call to me from its immense hill when I went bounding once more in the spring, full of ambition and silence. When she was a little girl, the shopkeeper was given candles as gifts by her elderly grandmother. And so on rainy days, she carefully lit the candles as her mother watched over her. And then she played with dolls and drew horses with crayons and looked over at the tiny flame once in a while, fascinated by how it dwindled and how the shape of the candle changed as it got smaller and smaller. She loved them all. When the wicks of the candles became too worn and the wax too diminished, her mother would tell her it was time to throw them away. But she didn't like to see them disposed of, and so she decorated a shoebox to keep them in. Her mother humored her. Into the box went the retired, somewhat decrepit candles, green, blue, and red ones, though the little girl couldn't really say why. She placed the box under the bed, and when her grandmother passed away, the collection became fixed. There were 9 used candles in all, most likely never to be used again. At age 12, she pulled the box out again and told herself that the candles had a purpose. One day, she would take those stray odds and ends and melt them down to make a single, larger candle, so that the remnants would be reborn, their possibility renewed. She became very fond of the idea. Back under the bed went the shoebox, and even though it would stay there, unopened, for the longest time, she remembered her idea in odd moments as the years went by. She looked forward to the day when she would sit down and complete her project and recall each candle and what she did while it burned on a rainy day inside her childhood home. She eventually went off to college, and the box went into the attic. She next thought about those remnants sitting in a cafe after a job interview, and she hoped the box was still somewhere safe. She got the job she interviewed for, and it took her away from her home state, and she got married 3 years after that. She happened to mention her candles to one of her bridesmaids when a red gift box reminded her of the shoebox, telling her that one day her little candles would live again as part of a greater whole. She was almost 40, and 4 years divorced, and lonely, when the thought of those candles came to her once again as she stood in her kitchen late at night, the silence all around her oppressive and haunting. A great feeling of hope embraced her. She called her sister in Vermont and asked her where the box might be. Her sister told her that if it still existed, it would most likely be somewhere in the family's self-storage unit in town, placed there a couple of years before their mother and father had passed away. The shopkeeper used her next 2 days off from work to drive the 400 miles to her sister's house. After dinner on Saturday, she traveled through the rain to the self-storage park and opened Unit 242. There was so much to sort through, so much. After an hour of searching, she had almost given up, but then she came across a big plastic crate marked with her name in faded black letters. Under a pile of her old school books was the red shoebox she had decorated at the age of 10. She sat down on the floor in one corner of the unit as the rain drummed down outside. When she removed the lid, there they were. Almost 30 years old, the 9 candles worn down to pale imitations of their once fully shaped selves, their wicks useless with age. Pieces of wax had broken off with time and handling. These she would not let slip past her attention. This very night, she would take the misfits, the little candles that had been waiting more than 2 decades in darkness, to become whole again, and meld them to make a single candle she would take with her into the next stage of her life. She would create a symbol of renewal, a candle that would never be burned at all, always containing within it the essence of those patient, yearning others. Beside them in the box was a small mince tin, which only now did she recall for the very first time since touching it as a child. The sight of it brought tears to her eyes. Inside the tin, which she opened as delicately as she could, were the 9 matches her mother had used to light those candles. It all came back to her how she had wanted to keep them, too. There they were, tiny, withered, unable to form something bigger than themselves. They had lit the flames and then died without a sound for her. She cried at the shame of forgetting them and the joy of their discovery. These little soldiers, which were once objects of danger and fascination, never to be handled for fear of being burned, were now as helpless as anything she had ever touched. They ringed the single candle she created that night, sitting alone in the room where she had slept as a little girl. More than anything else, they looked like a slumping castle whose broken battlements would protect her dream. On a Friday night, I came home at 7:30, usual time. Liz was scrubbing the tub. I took the recycling out and separated it, glass and cardboard. She asked me if BLTs were okay for dinner, and I said yes. While she made those, I took another look at the porch light, trying to figure out how to get at the bulb to replace it. Then we ate. Liz read an article in Vanity Fair while she ate. She put on some sweatpants, and I watched a little news and tried to find a movie. There was nothing good on. She said just pick anything, so I did. Something we'd seen before. After the movie was over, she brushed her teeth, and I did too. And she put on a robe and got into bed. I went over to turn off the light near the big mirror. And she said, "The reason the suitcase is by the front door is because last Friday I told myself I was leaving you." She'd made the preparations and priced a plane ticket. She'd written her resignation letter for work. She'd told herself that putting the suitcase near the door was the first step. So that's how she'd begun. She wanted it to remind her of what needed to be done. Every day, I'd walked right past it. For 6 days, she'd gone to bed early because she was so exhausted from the stress. She said it felt like batteries were being taken out of her, one by one, as the days passed with her unable to go. Her very movements had become slower, heavier. She left work in the middle of the day to go back to her car and close her eyes and sleep. All she had wanted was one sign, one gesture from me, that she should stay with me. But it had never come. And somehow it had become the next Friday night. The closing credits of another cable movie watched together silently in the living room, her heart and her mind filled with sand. I said to her, "I know you were planning to leave me. I knew it as soon as that first step was taken. I knew it, so I had waited till Liz left for work on Monday, and I drove to a nursery. And I bought as many gardenias as I could. And I came back and I had filled that suitcase with them and zipped it up again and placed it exactly where she had left it by the front door. And for days I'd waited for her to open it." We spoke these things to each other, and when we were done, I said to Liz, "Now what do we do?" Well, here's what she did. She packed her things in two duffel bags as I waited outside our room. When she was done, she moved to the front door, kneeled, unzipped the suitcase, and she took out half the flowers, half. She held them in one hand and left the others where they were, and she very carefully drew the zipper back up. And she left me. I took the gardenias that stayed behind, chopped them, and spread them in the dirt just beyond the guest room window. It took a while, but more grew. I showed the garden to someone 2 years later, on a second date. And that guest room above it, my little daughter, is the place where you were born. At an estate sale in the country, I bought a framed painting of a summery harbor full of sailboats by the artist Christoph Vadia, who was mildly acclaimed in the middle part of this century for his optimistic depictions of rural and low-income workers at leisure. He was never exactly famous, and I was able to buy the painting for a mere $200. After it had hung in my study for a year, I thought I would research its real market worth. But my search revealed no work by Vadia called August Before the Fair, and I found not a single image depicting it on the internet. Every other painting that had survived Vadia was readily available for purchase through a website his granddaughter operated, but not mine. I began to think I might have a real find on my hands, or very possibly a work that had been completely disregarded with the passage of time. I took the painting to a gallery whose owner knew a little about Vadia. He told me, without much hesitation, that my purchase was a forgery. He pointed out the hues used in the water, the way the boats were shaped, and the faces of the people watching them. He compared August Before the Fair to three other Vadias he was able to find reproductions of in an old catalog, and especially pointed out how very different the artist's signature was on the one I had bought. Within 10 minutes, I myself was convinced that I had been duped, though the painting's chain of possession was certainly convoluted, and I had no intention of pursuing the matter. I took the painting home, and I put it back up on my wall. I felt as though I were really looking at it for the first time. I had the gallery owner's catalog with me, and I studied Vadia's originals while peering closely at August Before the Fair, struck by how wildly different they were. The forger had really not even been close to duplicating his style and technique, and it was only my complete innocence of the art world that had led me to believe I had something interesting on my hands. The boats, the water, the people, the sky, all were far more crude than Vadia's, far more rudimentary. And yet, the forger had used a greater variety of color than had Vadia, perhaps out of a lack of confidence. And while his lack of skill in depicting perspective made the onlookers seem all the same size, this somehow added to the sense that they had all come together as a group of disparate souls, to watch the regatta, dreaming of the day they might be able to have sailboats of their own. And the somewhat awkward shading of the clouds made them look half-friendly, half-threatening, so that I couldn't be sure if I was seeing a happy day that was about to become ruined by rain, or the blessed clearing of the weather and the emergence of those impoverished people after days of longing to be outdoors. I like to imagine that the person who painted my forgery began it for profit. Why else would he have signed it using Vadia's name? But like me, realized long after its completion that a different sort of masterpiece had been created. A testament to the skill of a greater man, but something that also captured the rough edges of a very different, vivid, dedicated imagination. How it must have hurt him inside, I thought, to spend such careful time and talent on something he knew was not his own. And perhaps there had been no profit motive after all, I would never know. Maybe he'd done it because Vadia had moved him, or he so badly wanted to be in that world of summer and light that he chose to become someone else to accomplish it. When I look at August Before the Fair now, I see those two men standing in the small, stuffy upstairs room I once wanted to turn into a painting studio, but never did. Christoph Vadia stands with one hand on the forger's shoulder, coaching his technique as he labors silently on the boats and the onlookers, but also encouraging every missed stroke and every unwise blending of color, so that the forger's vision remains his own. When it's all done, Vadya tells the forger to paint his own name in the corner, and he smiles as the man steps back to take in the remarkable sight of something he never believed he was beautiful enough to create. Through the prism of memory, the English professor looks at the people he's known in the first 55 years of his life, and he's able now to see which were his true friends and which were not. How clear it's all become with enough life experience. But more vividly, he sees the faces of women, and before them, the girls he liked and befriended, even those he had chatted with for a mere moment. Stifled now in a marriage to a woman he cares for deeply but is no longer in love with, female faces haunt him. The cellist at the Paganini concert in 1995. Her hand had touched his arm and she'd laughed at everything he'd said. Lauren from botany class, sophomore year of college. Now, and only now, does he understand what she meant when she said that he kept appearing in her dreams. The sister of a friend who had dropped by unexpectedly, thinking that he'd walked off with her umbrella after a group dinner the week before. Yes, he'd been blind, and the pieces fit now. Her drive must have been 20 miles or more to get to his apartment. Her demeanors recalled perfectly, dissected with total accuracy from the distance of years. The professor lies awake and ponders every transaction he ever had with these women he might have loved, if only he'd been able at the time to interpret their words and gestures correctly. But the present tense had kept him blind. It simply moved too fast. Too fast. Falling asleep, he has a dream in which all of them are standing on the shore of a quiet lake. They are all wearing white dresses. The women whose past gestures he now understands at age 55. He watches them from the opposite bank as they gently sweep the sand with thin brooms and place tiny rocks just so and brush away blown leaves in expectation that he will soon arrive to take just one of them away from where they are stranded. The shore is being made perfect for him. But he cannot get to them. There is no way over. He is grateful that they can't see him standing there across the water, helpless. As soon as they stop moving about in their white dresses, industrious but silent, they walk off into the woods behind them, returning to the lives they currently lead. Lives with families and children and jobs and loves that became real, leaving the English professor unremembered. When the last of them disappears from sight, he wakes. He touches his wife's shoulder softly. Sound asleep beside him, she does not move. She is 53. She had a similar dream of men preparing for an arrival that would never be more than 6 years before. They will both have that dream once more when they are very old. But this time, they will have no more memories of what the people on the far shore represent. They will have finally moved beyond the desire to recapture every lost chance for a love story with another human soul. Instead, they will find themselves quiet and content, gazing in fond wonder at the deep blue water before them, feeling only a slight pang of regret that, in their youth, on their busy honeymoon cruise, they somehow let slip away the chance to appreciate the serenity and beauty of the ocean. My uncle and I were watching a vintage rebroadcast of an old World Series game on television, and he told me that we were watching a game he had actually attended 38 years before as a teenager, having been given a single ticket by his father. He told me what it had been like to be there, part of that terrific atmosphere. In the fifth inning, the home team's star shortstop pulled a foul ball into the stands along the third base line. The camera panned over and cut closer to the space where a group of fans grabbed at the foul ball. One of them looked like my uncle. The brown hair and angular face were very similar to that of the man sitting across the room from me. As I watched, my uncle, who in 1974 never even believed his brother would one day marry and have two sons, tore the ball out of a boy's hands, seizing it for himself. The boy, no more than 12 years old, made a last attempt to claim the ball, but my uncle turned away sharply, securing it in what was more or less a theft. After a moment, he held it high over his head with pride, then turned to climb back over the three rows of seats he had bounded across to get to the foul. The game continued. After a moment's silence, I asked my uncle if that had really been him, and he said, very quietly, that it indeed was him. His face looked ashen as he said it. He couldn't believe he had done such a thing. I asked him where that ball was today. He replied that he didn't know. He was sure that meaningless souvenir was lost many years ago. It was just several months after we watched that game together that my uncle had the idea for the Freddy program. It cost him a lot of money and a lot of time, but he had not been able to get past witnessing what he had done at that World Series game. The Freddy program, slowly instituted at every big league ballpark, gave a free game ticket to any fan who offered a caught ball to a boy or girl sitting around him. My uncle had never known the name of the boy he had swindled so long ago and thought Freddy was as good a name as any. Not very long after the program took hold all around the league, a man in Rochester, New York, read about its origin and wrote to my uncle. He believed that he was the boy in 1974 who had originally scooped up that foul ball off the bat of the star shortstop. My uncle invited him to go with us to Game 4 of last year's World Series. We had a nice time. Driving back home, my uncle was unusually quiet. When I asked him what was wrong, he said he had been thinking more and more that he may not have been the young man on the grainy videotape we had watched of that game. He often thought these days that he'd been sitting in the upper deck that afternoon, and that the foul ball he'd managed to grab had bounced off a seat in front of him and been taken fairly. And I told him that I wasn't sure that the man we'd just been to the ball game with was really that boy who had been cheated. I thought I'd detected an innocent flicker of doubt on his face as they'd talked somewhat conflictingly about the details of that long-ago day, as if he'd gotten a little bit confused as well. My uncle and I pulled over at a rest stop off the highway 10 miles north of his house, and we got 2 gloves and a ball out of the trunk and played catch in the dark, working by the feeble lights in the parking lot to our left, my uncle's arm seemingly as strong as ever, and able to catch almost anything that came his way. The traveling salesman was sitting outside his motel room in the middle of the night when he experienced an emotion that had never before found its way inside his soul. It had been a hard week of driving across the region, staying at different motels. His wife had called him on the second night, asking for a divorce. After that, the biggest sale of his 20-year career was followed by the theft of his car. An old acquaintance had called him out of the blue just the night before, telling him that a mutual friend had died, one whom the salesman had cared for very much. And just 2 hours before he took a cheap plastic chair out near the soda machine to get some air and watch the lights on the highway, he had left a message for his boss. He was quitting, effective tomorrow. He wasn't sure what he was going to do next, but he felt anything was possible. Sitting there in the humid night, unable to sleep, he began to feel strange. All the enormous changes he was going through seemed to suddenly collect in a heavy, unseen mass, blanketing his mind. It was all too much, too much. He felt half terrified, half exhilarated. The future, the past, and the present all swirled together, each unresolved, unsettled, as much a mystery as they ever were. He tilted his head back and it all came crashing in then, his life, all of it, surrounding him, strangling him, and trying to free him. He sat perfectly suspended between profound sorrow and great happiness. He could not get up from the chair, could not even open his eyes. A thunderstorm of confusion held him utterly immobile. His breathing was heavy. His hands opened and closed. Then, through a conscious effort, he let it all go. "I now let it all go," he thought. And suddenly he felt himself inwardly falling, falling through it all, his body and mind limp. Down, down he went in terror and joy. Everything that he was and had ever been, descending through miles and miles of black night sky. It lasted only 2 full minutes, this otherworldly descent that no one could see. When he opened his eyes again, it was over. It was over, and he was all right. He had made it through the chaos and remained alive. He had never kept a diary and never would. But the next day he wrote in a spiral notebook, that what he had felt could only be described in that one word, falling. It was an emotion he never knew existed, a blur of the best and worst that the human heart could feel, an inseparable tangle of joy and sorrow, terror and exhilaration, so immense that it caused a visceral tumble through inner space. Where he had landed, he thought later, was out of his control. Falling could either be the last emotion a person would ever feel, or the first one of a new life. 9 years went by before he met one other person who had experienced it. The traveling salesman was able then to call it by its name, which to this day remains unknown to all but a few, all of them having fallen, and all of them safe on the other side. I had come back north on the red eye from Atlanta and walked through an airport sleepy with museum-like silence. I thought I recognized the woman almost right away, even though her hair had gone gray and she seemed much smaller to me. It had been 2 decades. When she hung up the payphone near the gate, looking frustrated, she turned to me and, before I could say anything, she expressed her disappointment with the person who was supposed to be giving her a ride back to her home, but had apparently fallen asleep. I offered her a lift into town, and she accepted it. Yet I still did not introduce myself, because I wondered if somehow she might recognize me first. As we drove along the quiet highway, the radio turned very low. She watched the passing nighttime scenery and talked about some troubles she'd been having with her foot and with her brother, who she lived with now, her husband having passed away 3 years before. I asked her what she did for a living. She was retired now, she said, but had been a middle school teacher for 37 years. I asked her how she had liked it. She hadn't, she said. She'd been obligated to go into it by a domineering mother and had never really understood teenagers. The administration had been difficult to work with, the pay had been poor, the discipline aspect tough for her to deal with. She'd been bored with teaching most of the time, she said, and wanted to be away from it. But the force of habit and a lack of confidence had kept her mired. She considered it her greatest failing, continuing in a job she didn't care for until all her dreams were gone. And on a day-to-day basis, the many irritations that came with the job had made her more sour than she would have thought possible. We were quiet for a bit after that. I was humbled, somewhat saddened. I dropped her off in front of her little house just 5 miles from where I lived myself. The reunion between the unhappy teacher and the mediocre former student who had known her only briefly in the 7th grade ended. We shook hands briefly and she thanked me. Finally, I couldn't resist it. I told her that she had been an instructor of mine 22 years before, and I gave her my name. She took a moment to place it. Then she nodded, smiling. She told me which classes I had with her, and that I had always sat in the 3rd row. She recalled the exact name of my final paper for English literature, and that I had written a short play for extra credit that year. She remembered that she gave me a B and not a C because of my class participation. My old teacher went into her little house, and I drove away. The carpenter took a day off work and decided to walk the length of the Clarence Trail, which led 16 miles west from the center of the city. He filled his backpack with sunscreen and energy bars, and took a book and went on his way, in a very good mood. He had a fine autumn day walking, and only around mile 11 did he really begin to feel tired, his feet sore, his neck a little sunburned. The clouds came out near dusk, and rare thunderheads gathered. He lost the trail going through the town of Pell, which he had never been to. It was a quiet collection of tasteful houses, a library, a park. He stood on the corner of Sapling and Heverlow, deliberating his next move, wondering where to catch the bus home, when he noticed a woman waving at him from inside her house. She came out onto the step, smiled, said he looked so tired and thirsty and hard-traveled that she would gladly give him some water if he wanted it. He smiled, thanked her, and accepted it. Unshaven, carrying his battered backpack, he supposed he looked like he might have been on the road for days, weeks, months, and he did not dissuade her from that notion, grateful to feel like a real journeyer. She wound up giving him lemonade in her kitchen as a light drizzle began to fall. They talked about all sorts of things, her job at the recreation center, the price of real estate, favorite ice creams, memories of elementary school. They were about the same age, had a lot in common. He never told her he was from the city. It simply didn't seem to come up. At one point, she asked if he was hungry, and she cooked some pasta on the stove for them both. He had two helpings. After that, it seemed they had run out of conversation for the time being. She commented on how tired he looked from walking, and he said yes, he was. What he really wanted more than anything in the world, he said, only half-jokingly, was a nap before he hit the road once more. It was almost dark out when she led him upstairs to a tiny guest room and laid a quilt on the bed. She left him there and told him that if she were gone when he awoke, it meant she had left to buy groceries, and he could just let himself out any time. She wished him good luck. He stretched out on the bed, as sore and tired and happy as he could ever remember, and he fell asleep. When he awoke, it was raining heavily outside, and it was almost 8 p.m. Car headlights washed past the window every 5 or 6 minutes. He lay there, looking at the ceiling. He heard the woman downstairs putting groceries away. Everything was very quiet in the town of Pell. He told himself that he would rise in 10 or 15 minutes and go down the stairs of the little house, and his new life would begin then. He wasn't ever going back. Here in Pell, he felt as far away from his old world as he ever had, safe, a new person, ready to start again. There was nothing in his past to be ashamed of or run from, but why not stay here? Why not? He would live in the house with the woman, and they would be happy. They would work and be together, and on weekends he would build things for her and take care of the lawn, and they would love each other and life itself. Just 11 miles from his old home, it could all happen. The rain fell, and he could hear it hitting a recycling bucket far below his window. From down the stairwell, there was the very faint sound of a radio playing classical music. Turning his head slightly on the soft pillow, he watched the silhouette of a tree outside, bending slightly in the wind. When all was said and done, and he had nights without end there on Sapling Street to lie in the dark and muse about that autumn day, he considered his choice not a miracle or an act of bravery, but a whim that had simply worked out. A nice moment in the town of Pell, drawn out across an expanse of years, like a quilt stretched across a bed. I was morose as I left the all-night grocery store, ruminating endlessly on an opportunity lost. History seemed to be repeating itself once again, and only by losing myself in the vast, overlit aisles did I feel like I could get away from myself, if only for an hour. After putting all my bags in the trunk, I walked around to the driver's side door, checking my receipt, convinced I had been the victim of a double charge for my cereal. Irritation joined my depression as I stood in the bitter cold, trying to make out little numbers by the feeble glow of the overhead lights. A strong wind blew up and tore the receipt from my hand. I swore aloud as it somersaulted skyward. But instead of settling back down on the earth, the receipt continued its delicate tumble, arcing away, borne by a wind that would not let it go. Up beyond the parking lights it sailed, becoming smaller and smaller. It seemed less like a piece of paper than a bird intent on being free. I stood watching it, awed by the perfection of its journey. It spun and swooped, hesitating sometimes, but never descending. Soon it faded into the black sky, a tiny star, winking out of existence before my eyes. Then it was gone. I had never seen something quite like it before. A bit of debris, pulled forcefully into a different destiny just moments before I could crumple it and throw it into the trash. For all I knew, it would float in the night sky forever. The next day was just as windy, and being at loose ends, I stood for a time in my backyard, letting small pieces of paper be pulled from my right hand to see if I could duplicate the surprising event of the night before. I could not. I let dozens of tiny stars get caught by the breeze, but none of them carried very far before swooping low to the cold ground. I went for a walk in the woods as dusk fell, and there, sitting atop a fallen tree, was my grocery receipt. It was unmistakably true. The items I had bought were listed on it. The receipt had suffered a great tear down the middle. It was stained in one corner, and there was a small hole where the price of my cereal used to be. But it was mine. It had landed a half mile from the place where it had been borne aloft. Since then, alone in the world, it had gone through a considerable trial. I took it home, wondering what to do with it. After dark, I walked out into the middle of the street, and I waited for the wind to rise. There was no chance, I knew, no chance at all that this bit of paper could take off again, defying logic and science. Such a forlorn scrap could only be famous for one moment, its first flight, or even two, its rediscovery, but never a third. I was only setting myself up for mild disappointment. Yet my heart was racing as the seconds passed, and I chose with every fiber of my being to believe in something. The possibility of a miracle held within a beaten, withered grocery receipt. I held it delicately between two fingers, and after about a minute, it was caught and taken away from me. On his 81st birthday, the sociologist was honored by the college at which he had taught for the past 2 decades. It was quite an event. He had become famous for his books and even appearances on TV panel shows over the years. The celebration had been moved up several months because he was now in failing health and had officially retired from teaching in January. Still, on this night, he gave a strong speech and received a standing ovation. There was an hour of handshaking and wine sipping after the event, and then the sociologist decided to walk home alone. It was only a mile back to his house, and he didn't feel too sickly tonight. He thought he had just enough energy to make it back home. He waited till everyone was gone and crossed the campus. It was a little past 11. His wife was off visiting her sister, so he would be returning to an empty house. He had been having such strange emotions recently, and not just those related to the confrontation of what would probably be the last months of his life. He felt a seemingly irreparable sadness, and he didn't know why. His life had been a very good one indeed, full of travel, scholarship, acclaim, love. He'd been married twice, rather happily both times, had 2 happy grown children. It had been about 20 years since he'd gotten his greatest renown, when he'd published a book detailing a theory he'd developed about human behavior. The book had become a bestseller and had no small impact on the way many people perceived their lives. The theory stated, in essence, that any vocation, hobby, or behavior that a person engaged in, which was shared by only 5% of his fellow humans, should be examined carefully by that individual. For if he was unhappy, this outside-the-herd behavior was quite likely one of the roots of his unhappiness. If a person kept snakes, for example, or had 3 jobs instead of 1, or was only attracted to redheads, or had chosen to live alone on an island, or wore the same clothes every day, unusual aspects like these needed to be re-evaluated constantly because they tended to hint at a slightly broken psychology, even if they seemed to produce positive effects or made the individual feel unique or special or led to great success. Now, as the sociologist walked home, A man drove by, blaring rock music from his speakers. His car, garishly tricked out and mechanically altered at obviously great expense. And the sociologist couldn't help but think, yes, another one who has gone too far outside the herd and doesn't see it. He walked along Caledonia Street, feeling so sad. Yes, he knew that the arc of his very own career had put him into that outlier 5%. The fact wasn't lost on him. So he had long followed his own advice and spent much time reevaluating his stature. But this wasn't what was making him forlorn, he knew. What was it? He got all the way back to his house, starting to feel deeply fatigued, dizzy, old and frail. He was about to put his key into his door when he stopped, sat down on the front step, and thought some more. Since 1992, when his book was published, he had never once come across or been confronted with any evidence that his 5% theory was incorrect or flawed in any provable way. Sitting there past midnight, he mused on this. It was true. It was no accident that it had become so well known. In a lifetime of mysteries, of victories and tragedies that made little sense, of mistakes and faulty breakthroughs, of misunderstandings, truths which slipped away, and conundrums which could never be solved, he felt he had somehow locked down a tiny piece of the human puzzle. And this, he realized, was what was bringing him this melancholy. How much more wonderful life was when we simply never understood what made people tick, or what caused the universe to mete out its millions of destinies. He had gone his whole life wondering, deliriously lost like everyone else, and quite by accident, he had found one answer. How he wished now that he never had. He would have loved to have passed from the earth, never truly knowing anything. He pondered whether the great scientists and mathematicians throughout history felt the way he did at the end of their lives, having made the regrettable mistake of figuring something out. That, thought the author of the 5% rule, was truly the most isolating act a person could commit. He let out a little laugh, sitting there on the step. He decided on the spur of the moment that since he was such an outlier, such a tragic case, he would go all out and live it for all it was worth. He walked over to the bench beside his wife's tiny front yard garden, and he stretched out on it. He was sleeping out tonight. The great scholar, at age 81, soon to be gone, set aside his dignity and fell asleep outdoors, 10 steps from his front door, hopefully to become an object of gentle pity. A lost and elderly soul so confused about life, he didn't even know how to get inside his comfortable home anymore. A child drifting through the universe without answers, just grateful that the night was warm. I walked through Kinsale one evening, long after dark. I wanted only to see, to notice. Crossing Atlanta Avenue, I saw a Greenberry Park ahead of me. Under the full moon, I saw a sign there that said, "No use after sunset." This statement was helped by a visual. A solid red square with a single diagonal black line running through it. This was how "No use after sunset" was depicted graphically. There was a tiny, dumpy Chinese takeout place called the House of Fortune. Inside were bare white walls and two tables in all, also bare white. Sterile, totally uninviting. The place was open, but no one was minding the counter. Walking around the side of the building, I curled around and passed the rear kitchen entrance. Its door was glass, very dirty, aged, locked, affording a small view of just the rearmost sliver of the kitchen. The portion of the wall I could see in there was gray and featureless, lit in the night by a single low-watt bulb. There, sitting on a countertop unattended, was a giant tray filled with yellow noodles. I waited for a few minutes to see if anyone would take them away, but of human presence there was no sign. I headed toward Kinsale Memorial Park and the Judean Memorial Gardens. The headstones were all embedded in the ground, so all that could really be seen looking horizontally were patches of flowers. Walking around, I saw many graves of World War II veterans. But strangely, none had risen above the rank of private. At one point, I stopped and looked across the cemetery, down a slight downslope. The flowers laid on the earth seemed somehow out of place with the natural environment. There was almost no color left in the trees there. It was November. Yet the flowers were so colorful, even at night. I saw a lot of purple, pink, aqua, yellow, orange, and bright red. The scene almost seemed too festive. Pinwheels seemed to be popular nowadays. I approached a grave that had five of them planted in front of the stone. There was green, pink, and blue. The stone read, "Beautiful, beautiful brown eyes. Love you forever. Caroline Wilder." The most attractive body of water that night in Kinsale was a little man-made runoff pond beside a new housing complex. In the weeds nearby lay an 8-foot length of some kind of pipe, black and red and gold, bulging out in a couple of places, big bolts attached to it. It looked like a robot had crawled out of the pond and lay down to sleep before reaching the main road. I stepped over a long, long length of orange rubber temporary fence that bordered the woods, and I headed into them under the moonlight. I listened for things scuttling through the leaves, but I heard nothing. At one point I crouched, and I could make out a tiny field mouse. It had no idea that the woods it lived in, almost completely surrounded by temporary fence, were due to be razed, and that almost everything else had left already. It scurried away from me, happy as could be. On my way out of Kinsale, I saw the headquarters of the construction project that would soon redo the east side of town over the course of 2 long years. It was very late by that point. The whole world was asleep. There was a glimmer of human presence. 2 men in heavy work clothes walked under a string of lights toward a trailer which served as an office. One of the men clapped the other on the back in friendship, nodding. The other opened the door to the trailer, and they disappeared from view. My sights and sounds of Kinsale, so varied and wonderful, ended there, and the full moon guided me home.